Please welcome our next speaker from Integral Ad Science, who's going to discuss ad fraud beyond botnets, Jason Shaw. Jason. Welcome.
Thank you, John. Thank you to all of you for attending. As he mentioned, I'm from Integral Ad Science. We are the largest media quality measurement company in the industry, covering brand safety, viewability, fraud, of course, causal impact, and others. I lead our anti-fraud lab, which is based in Seattle. And today, I'll be talking about going beyond botnets. The reason is because, to this point, there's been a very healthy, and a very productive focus in the industry on addressing the challenges posed by botnets and the contributions they make to ad fraud. But the story certainly does not end there. To frame how I would like us to think about fraud and what it is in our industry, I want to return to this notion of what the mission of advertising is, where we're attempting to deliver the right message to the right person in the right place. And if we can achieve these three things, then we have the chance of influencing consumers in the way we would like, either by driving purchases or achieving brand lift or some other goal. But if any of these portions of the circle are tampered with, then our ability to influence decreases and in some cases is obliterated completely. So what I'd like to do is walk through each of these portions of what our goal is as advertisers or as an industry and illustrate how deceptive practices, how fraudulent information can distort this. To illustrate what I mean, let's just return to discussing botnets themselves for a second. A botnet is composed of bots. So what is a bot? A bot is nothing more than a computer which has been taken over by software to do whatever ends the software author has in mind. So this is very frequently, as we heard earlier, this is very frequently a personal PC, whether it's behind a residential network or a corporate network. It can just be an ordinary person using their computer, but through some unsafe browsing practices or malicious drive-by downloads or things of that nature, it gets turned into a bot by having malware installed on it. This malware is able to communicate with the person who's controlling the installation and execution of this malware. And if you get enough of these computers together, or if you get enough computers infected this way, you have a botnet. And so with all of these computers at your disposal, there are many things you can do with this, including many that we're familiar with outside of advertising, such as sending large volumes of spam, scraping content for websites to steal it, generating denial of service attacks on businesses or entities that the spammer or the hacker doesn't like, stealing credit card information, committing fraudulent financial transactions, and of course what we're concerned about today, advertising fraud, which of course has various incarnations. I'm talking about advertising fraud here, and in particular I'll be focusing on impression fraud. So given this mode of operation, why do we call this fraud? What does it actually mean for something to be fraudulent? Legal definitions of fraud vary depending on your jurisdiction, but the core elements of this are creating a material harm, such as a loss of money or inventory, and doing that through deception, where somebody has set out to deceive a party and then thereby cause the material harm. This happens with botnets because what you think is an opportunity to send your message to a consumer is not actually such an opportunity. It's being delivered to a piece of software and nothing else. So when we look at this in the context of these three pieces of what the goal of advertising is, the message is not getting through. So botnets are an example of a type of fraud that affects the message. When we talk about the message, there's an understanding that an ad unit is an opportunity to deliver your message, and hopefully it's to the right person at the right time. Certainly, there are cases where this doesn't happen because a person never sees it. This can happen for completely, you know, legitimate, unpredictable reasons. Somebody doesn't scroll the ad into view and never becomes viewable for whatever reason. And that's not what I'm talking about. What I am talking about is the fact that when you buy an ad, you're expecting that there's a genuine chance that somebody's going to see it. And if that chance is not genuine, that's fraud. So besides botnets, there are a number of ways this can be achieved. Most similarly, there's something that that we call volunteer botnets. This is a scheme that that we've uncovered in our lab, whereby rather than generating a large collection of computers through distributing malware without the user's permission, you actually have users who control a website, or perhaps they're trying to monetize some video that they've uploaded to a content sharing site. And what they can do is sign up for this organization, download the software to their own computer deliberately, and then run this software, which will automatically browse to the URLs of other people within the network. And in so doing, they gain credit within the network, at which point other people will begin to browse their site. So it's a you scratch my back, I'll scratch yours kind of arrangement, where everybody essentially donates their bandwidth and computing power in return for visits to their websites. And this can happen both with PCs or by leveraging cloud services. It can even be profitable there. And this is distinct from malware in important ways, because this browser is not running headless, meaning it may actually be displaying in a full browser window even though no one's paying attention to it, or it's running on a server without maybe a monitor attached to it. And again, it's completely voluntary on the part of the participants. And moving away from non-human traffic, it's possible to leverage genuine organic traffic this way. So the next couple of examples we heard about earlier, and I'll just go through them again because they can be confusing. This is what's known as ad stacking, where the gray rectangle in the lower right of the page is an ad unit that's up for sale. And instead of loading one ad into this slot, as would be expected, instead, we're going to have an HTML document with several ads all pushed into it. We insert that into the ad slot, and of course, only one of them fits. And so the rest of these ads are just hidden by the structure of the page. No one can see them. There's no genuine chance that message got across. Similarly, to similar effect, but varying depending on who is trying to generate these schemes, you can achieve this differently by doing pixel stuffing. And in this case, you have very tiny 1x1 iframes that would go completely unnoticed by the user, placed around the page. And inside these iframes, you load entire other websites. And of course, since they're embedded in these tiny pixels, no one can see them. But every ad that's on those embedded websites has been loaded to the user, and people are buying those impressions. So those are a few ways that your message can get lost by being lied to about the fact that an opportunity is actually there to tell your message. Next, I'd like to consider the environment. So how can we lie about the environment in order to generate more revenue than we deserve, or any revenue at all? So the big culprit here is known as domain spoofing. And there are a couple different key ways of committing this that I want to describe for you. The first is simply by manipulating the ad tag. So in this case, we've got this guy here wearing a trench coat. Inside his trench coat, he's got a bunch of Rolex watches. Or at least that's what he tells you. That's what he's going to sell you. And he's going to sell it to you for $50, which is fantastic. I've never seen a Rolex for so cheap in a store. Perhaps it's because he's escaped the brick and mortar that he's able to offer such a deal. And so you buy this watch from him, and not surprisingly, you've not ended up with a genuine Rolex. You can do something very similar with with ad tags. So if you're looking at an RTB environment where the URL is declared, there's nothing preventing, in many cases, the person who controls that ad tag from simply declaring whatever URL they want. And so you may be running on an extremely low-quality website with no original content. The content may be just cobbled together by stealing content from legitimate pages. Whatever the case may be, they'll just tell you that this is actually running on a premium news site. And you could buy it if you want, but you shouldn't be trusting that. The second means, which is a bit more complicated but can be even more pernicious because of the kind of the double whammy it can give you, is through something called cross-domain embedding. So what you've got here is a website that's dedicated to movie piracy. This is a website you can just go to watch movies for free. These are, you know, large films that would never be given away like this. And in the right down here, we have an advertisement that very likely whoever has placed this ad would not want to be putting it in a brand unsafe environment like this. But they didn't think they had done that. What they thought was that they were buying on a fashion site. So the way this worked was the film piracy site knows that they're not going to get very much ad revenue by selling ad slots the normal way because nobody wants to buy there. And this fashion site has basically no organic traffic of its own. And so it needs a way to generate organic traffic. So there's a sleazy network that steps in and offers to connect them. And it tells the film piracy site, I know how to get, you know, decent CPMs on your website to give you a good revenue stream. So let me place ads here. And it tells the fashion site, I know how to generate a lot of human traffic to your site that's viewable and will give you, you know, high quality ad revenue through your site. And what happens is a URL containing this ad is hosted on that fashion site, and then the network embeds it inside this piracy site. So the high organic traffic that's going to the piracy site is then being delivered ads on this other site. And as I mentioned, this is kind of a double whammy because not only are you being lied to about what the environment is, you're not getting what you paid for that way, you're also exposing your brand to serious brand safety concerns. So lastly, I'd just like to talk about the audience. So how can you be lied to about the person you're actually delivering your ad to? So a simple example, although not necessarily a significant monetary one at this point, is user agent spoofing. So there's a piece of information called the user agent, which is sent along with every HTTP request, when you request a website, when you then request the ad, et cetera. And it contains information about your browser environment. It usually details the operating system and version, the browser and version. It might have some information about plugins you have, et cetera. But since this is controlled by, or since this is information sent by the user's computer, the user can make modifications to it before it gets sent. And so it's very simple to be using your Windows computer and tell your browser to send things out with a Mac user agent instead. And so if you're targeting things based on user agent, for example, if you have an OS-specific software that you're looking to sell, then you're going to be targeting the wrong person. Another example is location fraud. So if you're looking to specifically reach people who are in a specific city or even a specific neighborhood or even a specific block in that neighborhood, you would like to know their location, their geographical coordinates. As a result, and this is especially prominent on, of course, in mobile advertising, when an advertisement opportunity comes along and you have the latitude and longitude information, that opportunity is much more valuable and garners much higher CPMs. app developers know this, and so they would like to provide that information for you. But users are required to actually consent to have that information shared. So when you see a user or an ad unit come up for sale, and you're told that the user is in New York or that the user is in London, they may actually be in Paris. And the reason is because this information is under the control of the app developer. And so what can happen is when they don't have consent, or even if they do have consent, but they know what locations are more valuable, they can simply insert whatever locations they like. So they may be just choosing random cities and taking important lat longs in there and sending them along. Or even in one case, these were just randomly generated. So if you looked at all of the geographical coordinates of the users for one particular app, you saw that they fell into a nice rectangle in the center of the United States. It was just a random number generator that was sending this information along. It was complete garbage. So the notion of fraud goes far beyond botnets or just non-human traffic. Whenever considering what it is that you can do to ensure that you're not being defrauded in your activities, there are three questions you need to ask, and they tie back to this mission of advertising. In the first place, you need to ask if it's a real opportunity to tell your message, or if that's being misrepresented to you. You need to ask if this ad is going to be where you're told it's going to be, if the environment is actually what it's represented as. And lastly, is this ad going to be delivered to who you were told it was? And of course, the ways that these questions can be answered, or the ways that these components can be manipulated, go beyond just the examples that I've shown. So it's critical to always be asking yourselves these questions. And so at Integral, we have a few points of view as to what the best ways of attacking this are. In the first place, we believe it's critical to operate at scale. We see about 4 billion impressions a day in the browser, as well as many more through RTB integrations. We also believe operating at scale is critical in order to facilitate the sort of comprehensive view of the industry, as well as the statistical power that's needed to do a lot of these things. Secondly, we believe you need to attack this from multiple angles. So a very strong data science component is critical to really understand what the different patterns are that we're seeing and what they mean in order to uncover new schemes as they're developed. But in addition, it's important to have a strong technological prowess as well, both on the side of white hats who can track down botnets and other means of automating traffic and understand how they operate and where they're going next, as well as a very strong web technology capability, both in developing detection mechanisms through collecting in-browser signals, as well as providing solutions. And lastly, we believe in protecting the industry as a whole. We think this is a problem that everybody has a stake in, and that everybody can contribute to fighting. So at Integral, we provide our data across the industry on the buy side and the sell side. If you're a publisher and you would like to ensure that you are not helping contribute to this problem unwittingly, you may want a solution that can help you monitor your traffic or screen it before you sell it. If you're an advertiser, you want to be able to get more detailed information before you bid, or be able to prevent an ad from serving when you find out that you've been deceived. So thank you very much. I will be around, and if you have any questions, I'd love to chat with you more.